This is Right On, the podcast where we talk to screenwriters and other industry professionals about screenwriting. Right On is brought to you by Final Draft. I am your host, Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft. And today I am, well, really excited to bring on a guest who has been a friend of mine for the last, I'd say, solid 2 years now, Cleve.
Yeah, I'd say so.
So we've been working together for a long time trying to develop some new features for production side of Final Draft 11, and we're very excited to be able to release that now. That's out and waiting. You'll hear a little bit more about that towards the end of the podcast. I got to introduce our guest. Cleve Landsberg is a producer, UPM, line producer. He's worked on stuff like Flash Forward, Training Day, Wicked City, Bruce Almighty, BASEketball, Weekend at Bernie's. It's a long list. It's going to keep going. Otherwise, Cleve has also been awarded the DGA Frank Capra Award for Career Achievement in Film and an Emmy Award for Visual Effects for Carl Sagan's Cosmos and a Humanitas Award for William Faulkner's Old Man. So, Cleve, there's so much more I could go on about, but I'm going to introduce you there. Cleve Landsberg, thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
So we always start with a little bit about how you got into the industry and how your career started.
Okay, that's a good story. Maybe a good story. We will have to be the judge. I was sort of born into it. My father was a television pioneer. He founded KTLA for Paramount Pictures in the 40s, experimental, and then it turned commercial in the late 40s. And so I was around it from birth, and he'd take me everywhere, and I was in everybody's hair because a lot of the crew at the station had to babysit me and stuff like that. Unfortunately, my father died when I was about 10 and a half, and I begged for a summer job towards the end of high school. They were kind enough to let me do the mailroom routine and summer relief. And then, you know, while I was in college at UCLA, I was able to get a job working on the stage and remote crew where you did everything, basically. And that was the best baptism into the industry that I could have had, because live television is a pressure cooker like few others. And you had to do everything. You had to think on your feet and continually innovate. And if you screwed up, your dirty laundry was on the air. So yeah, anyway, then I, you know, eventually decided at that point that I was going to make a career in the business. I love the smell of napalm in the morning, I guess. And continued on. I did it. I got my master's degree at UCLA. Then spent a couple of years in the Army. I was fortunate enough to shoot film and edit film, as well as do television production for secret projects and closed circuit support on those secret projects. And then started my career and worked my way through a variety of things, NBC News as an editorial assistant and working in facilities in post-production, and decided I wanted to be in the frontline production mode and started in that. And that my career just went on from there. It's a long, long story from there. So hopefully that's good enough for you.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think maybe the shorter bio for you in the future, I'll just list the jobs you've never done on set and in production. That would be a short list.
Very few.
From there, of the main jobs you have, UPM producer, line producer seem to come up the most. So can you talk about maybe what that transition was like for you, how you got to start doing these jobs as sort of the routine?
I was doing a broad variety of things in non-Directors Guild type of projects, from very special work with experimental, well, not experimental, it became mainstream, the Magicam cutting edge visual effects, which we won. I was part of, you know, won an Emmy Award for visual effects. And we worked on the Cosmos series with Carl Sagan way back when, and gosh, a whole bunch of things. But then I worked my way in, finally got my days to get in the Directors Guild, and immediately was UPMing a lot of things. I'd already kind of done stage managing and some assistant directing in non-guild, but got into the guild as a UPM, and very shortly thereafter, because I'd already done a little bit of producing by the time I got in the guild, I was producing and production managing television movies in particular. Long-form television movies were my meat and potatoes for many years, and did a lot of very big projects doing both capacities at the same time. Just something of, you know, I was comfortable handling both positions in the circumstances that we found ourselves, and there were a broad variety of those. And so, you know, it just kind of went on for years and years. And over the years, I've been UPMing and production managing, well, production managing and line producing all of my career. So that's kind of the summation of it. I've been doing this and started with computerized budgeting and scheduling when it began in the 80s. So it's been kind of fun, which is why I've enjoyed what we've been working on with Final Draft.
So what about, you just touched on for a second the idea of getting your days in to get into the Director's Guild, because that's not something writers face. We don't have to write a certain number of days, fortunately or unfortunately,
to be a writer. The Writer's Guild. All you need is a job. Actually, it's only in the UPM and AD categories that you have to kind of get enough days to get on what we call the Southern California qualification list to then qualify to work on any show that is a Director's Guild covered show. But any director, anybody that gets a directing gig can join the Director's Guild and be a director member. So much easier. And that's why you find a number of writers will want a director, get the ability to direct the show, and they come straight into the guild as a director member.
So what does that mean to just, let's take it even simpler, to get days? Because I don't think a lot of people know what that really means. How do I get a day working anywhere if I'm not in the guild already?
Well, there are non-union shows of one kind or another, and those still exist. A lot of those are low budget. Back in the day, it was an interesting variety. More often than not, in television, it was non-network, but there were also non-guild features and stuff like that. There's less of it these days because in the Directors Guild, we have, and it's too long to really talk about, but low budget agreements that have different structures, different rates of pay for smaller scale productions and allow our members and in some cases with low non-members, the ability to, get production days, shoot days and prep days, which some will count, and get onto a qualification list, whether it be in the third area, as we call it, or the New York qualification list or the Southern California qualification list. So rather complicated to explain. A lot of people don't really understand the details of it, but you get a certain number of minimum days and then you qualify for one of those qualification lists, and that can allow you membership. And there are other ways, but that's a little too complicated to explain the variety of ways that, you know, one can become a Director's Guild member.
Let's do another piece that I don't think people really understand. What is a UPM? Why is that position so central?
It's changed over the years to a degree, but basically has always remained the same. UPM stands for Unit Production Manager. In the old studio days, a production manager per se might be responsible for a large number of projects at a studio. And so a unit production manager was the production manager who worked on a specific film or project or TV series or something of that nature. And the responsibilities are very broad and extensive. In the very, very old days, the UPMs were kind of the central authority on the set. You would have a very limited number of producers involved with films. And out on location, you would maybe have one producer and one unit production manager and your director, and you'd have some very simple situations to do a production. There were many television movie show that I would do as the producer and UPM, and it'd be just the director and myself. We wouldn't have executive producers with us. We were entrusted to make the film and deliver it and come back with the right product. Does that help you?
Yes, I think that's a great answer. Okay. Let's go to the next one, line producer, and exactly what that means, because I think a lot of people have misconceptions there.
Oh, there are plenty of misconceptions, and those misconceptions, regardless of what I tell you, will continue, I'm sure. Line producer in this day and age is generally someone who bridges a little more of the creative issues and is still responsible for the delivery of the project, feature film, television show, whatever it is, and we'll deal with some more extensive levels on the creative production interface. A UPM has always done that where the situation requires, and that's particularly the way it was in the old days. The workload on a lot of shows, particularly, say, a television series, it's very hard to do both positions. I produced and production managed a TV series called Kingdom, which we finished up last year. And it's unusual, but it still occurs depending on the nature of the project and whether or not you have the correct staffing, nature of the show where you can do that. But more often than not, you will need a line producer and a unit production manager to handle the television series correctly. And very often, the unit production manager will also have a co-producer title because of the experience and the nature of the role that they're going to fulfill.
So what about that line producer job that's coming on? I mean, you, devil's advocate here, you just make a schedule and sit back and let it go, right? You're done.
The process of making a feature film or a television series or a miniseries or a television movie, fundamentally the same. You know, you have to deliver a product. You have a collaborative situation where all hands need to be talking and working on the same page, decisions together. Some people have the right communication skills to achieve that. Sometimes you have friction and breakdowns. The people that do it well, by and large, will figure out how to bridge those divides wherever they might occur. But when you have a team of, let's say, a television series, you have a showrunner who's an executive producer, you probably have a multitude of other executive producers and producers, many of which are augmented writer titles for staff writers and such. Hard to know who's who in the zoo, but at the end of the day, the line producer and the showrunner are the two pivotal points as far as a number of the creative decisions and then physical execution, but the unit production manager is right in the middle of it and has to help implement at every level and communicate with every department. Every show has its own structure, its own nature of the people and their particular strengths and weaknesses, and you're always looking to have the right blend and combination where it's working for that particular show.
Yeah, I guess that's really that symphony, and if you're in the middle of that symphony, you're conducting.
Yes, I've been a conductor a number of times.
Let's talk about how you get a script, where you are. You know, are you sitting on your couch and someone calls and there's a script in your lap? Is that how it works? What happens? How do you get involved in something normally?
Oh, there's so many different ways. It's impossible to say it happens this way or that way. It can be a call out of the blue and say, please, I need to do this thing. I need to figure it out. I'm trying to get financing and so forth, and maybe a feature project. And they need a practical evaluation of what the film will cost, how many days of shooting it will take to do, some sort of overview of a plan. And this really kind of goes to the heart of the process. When I get a script, and it could come from a studio that needs a breakdown and a schedule, or they maybe need a budget as well, and in some cases, particularly on independent films, I will be asked to do breakdown, schedule, and budget. From those, a lot of assumptions are being made. And whether it's feature films or TV series or anything, there have to be a whole slew of assumptions that will have to be made and choices that essentially a person like myself will have to make, and you try to get input from all the people involved to try and narrow down the number of choices you have to make on your own in a vacuum. Challenging.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that vacuum because I don't think it's hard to get your head around. All right, well, I'm working on a budget, and I assume that lighting guys need $5,000 a day. You have to know that you need to ask them at some point, right?
Okay, let me give you a bit of an example. A script comes to me. It's a feature script. And I say, Cleve, we need to figure out how to do this. What's it going to cost? And I say, okay. And I will immediately ask some questions. Do you know approximately how much money you think you can raise to make this film? And maybe they'll say, oh, well, listen, it's going to be big. It's going to be this. It's going to be that. I think that to do it the way to make it right, we're going to need $80 million. I say, great. Okay. And then I will start to ask a series of other questions to understand methodologies about how we might do it. I remember way, way back when I was breaking down something for MGM feature project, and part of what I needed to know right off was, okay, do you have a director in mind for the project? Because if it was an A-list director, there would maybe be certain expectations of that A-list director that by a little research and by my own experiences, I could make assumptions as to what that level director is going to start expecting. Maybe start making some expectations, assumptions about the star power of the cast. Is there going to be just one major star carrying it, or is it going to be two, three, four supporting roles? And you have to start making some assumptions about how much money of that $80 million might get eaten up for a variety of things, and how much left over for the basic physicalities, how much for the rights, how much for doing a contingency and a completion bond on the film. And you work your way back within that box of $80 million, and you try to determine then, is it feasible? It may be feasible with some other assumptions, but not feasible with another set of assumptions. Then if somebody says, okay, well, no, there's no way we're going to get $80 million. The marketing people say that that they can only with foreign sales do X, Y, and Z, and maybe it can justify a budget of $20 million. Well, I immediately then have changed my thinking about all of the various assumptions, figure out just by breaking the script down by the way it tells me it wants to be shot, but I'm going to have to tailor my assumptions according to the box that they're ultimately going to have to get to. And then I will tell people based on my evaluation, my analysis, that if they want to do it for this particular price, it will fit in nicely if you do X, Y, and Z on how you cast the film or how much you allow for actors, how many days of shooting might be realistic, and what within that will be some choices to be made as far as bells and whistles, number of shooting days, how big a crew, where to shoot it, what incentives you might want to go for because of location requirements, and how that all fits together. So it's a potpourri of moving parts, and it all starts with evaluating the script, analyzing what the script is, in tuning into the vision of the scriptwriter, of the producers, the studio, the director, if a director is known, or you know what type of a director might be, and you start to visualize execution of that script into a film. And what is it going to take to put that film together with all the various elements and requirements that I can visualize? So when I visualize, I'm visualizing what's going to be on the screen, what you're going to see there in front of the camera. But at the same time, I have to visualize everything that's going to be behind the camera to support capturing that vision. It can get quite complicated if it's a little parlor drama and it all takes place in a house like Sleuth, if you remember that old film. Well, you would budget it differently than you would an action adventure that's got to shoot in multiple cities and has various chase scenes and stuff. And you're going to approach it a lot differently if you're doing Mission Impossible.
It seems like one thread in any of that matrix of stuff would pull on a lot of other threads. I mean, you mentioned location incentives where I get some tax money back because I shoot in New Mexico. But as soon as I make that decision, I get the tax incentives. Well, now do I have to get more flights and more hotels? And does that expense go up as a result of one decision that actually made the cost go down?
Well, let me give you an example. I produced a television pilot for ABC this past spring. We shot it in Dallas. Before I came on board, the executive producers and the studio did in the early going scouted a variety of locations, one of them being New Mexico. That they were looking to shoot locations that could help them depict something akin to Tucson, Arizona area. And New Mexico had certain things, but it didn't have others, and they didn't like it. And there are certain other things. And then because of an incentive, they were chasing New Mexico for that. And then they went chasing an incentive into Texas and wound up deciding to shoot in Dallas. Okay. So, you know, there's a variety of things. Once you learn what's there, you have to take advantage of what's there. You have to figure out what things are going to fit the story. And you go through that selection from the various choices for locations and determining the kind of crew you have available to you, how many crew you need to bring in. And you start balancing it out according to facts that emerge from your homework on what you have. There's a process of determining what circumstances you can take advantage of, but also circumstances that will enable the show to creatively satisfy the requirements of the story. While they might have been happier to go to New Mexico for economic reasons, it just didn't work for them on a creative level. And hence, New Mexico got rejected. Particular story. You start one particular place and there's a bit of a journey. Sometimes the journey can be more quickly achieved. And sometimes it can take weeks to sort out as far as what's right for the film or television pilot as this was, or shooting a series too, once you already have a pickup.
Yeah. And then you're just cranking episode by episode and you really have almost even more story to factor in. I mean, got hours.
The pilot we shot in Dallas, they wanted to do the series not in Dallas because it just didn't, it wasn't as wonderful as they initially thought it might be. So a decision was made that if it got picked up for series, it would be shot here in Los Angeles. And that the location availabilities of certain types of sets, locations, better fit duplicating what the story requirement. But there are other factors as well.
Sure, I imagine there's got to be a million.
Yeah, let me add something too, because you're talking about really the origins of what we do and in mounting a film or evaluating a film. It depends on what it is. Let's say, look at it from the standpoint of when you start to do what I do. Is it in pre-prep where, let's say, 20th Century Fox comes to me and says, Cleve, we need to figure out this particular script and see what we think it'll take to make it. And so they'll give me a script, and then I will do a breakdown, a schedule, getting as much information as I can to make the best assumptions. And this is for a very, very preliminary part of the process of greenlighting a film. It's prior to a greenlight of a film. It's an evaluation period to have numbers, have schedule, have assumptions about the feasibility of doing the project and what it would take to do it right with the assumptions, the best assumptions you can get from either what I would inject into the thing and bounce off of people, or what assumptions, answers to questions that other people at the studio or on a creative level can answer for me. So that's one way of trying to go and evaluate how to do all the things that we're talking about doing with final draft. And ultimately going into Movie Magic scheduling and then Movie Magic budgeting and stuff like that to accomplish all that. But if it's, for example, a television pilot, that's going to be a little bit different, and it's going to be probably after they've already decided that they're going to make it, and they have a green light to do it. Mm-hmm. And then it's hurry up, jump in. Break it down afresh and figure it out immediately with a short timeline to then hire people and mount the production and do it within the number that the studio believes that it's going to take and hopes to achieve, and try to set a specific parameter for you to work within. That's not always correct, and sometimes they discover that there were some things they didn't think of in the preliminary phase, and it all then has to do with how much deficit financing the studio might have to absorb on that pilot and take the risk, because the networks or whoever it is will only give them a certain number of a license fee, and that pilot's going to cost more than the license fee.
Right, so at that point, someone's got to take a real gamble.
Well, they do. And you go through this process in the early stages of say, well, it's a pilot with a green light. Maybe it's a series with a green light. And they've predetermined to a degree that they want to do it for a particular number that makes sense to them. But as we're going and doing this stuff, we're starting to work with different amounts of information. And, you know, as far as, you know, talking about what we've been working on the last 2 years, you and I, is how to get an aspect of Final Draft working better for a person like me, because I like to work in Final Draft, set it up so I can do a better evaluation and importing elements into Movie Magic scheduling, which is really the crux of the work you and I have been doing on what's known as Tagger.
I'll jump in there. I mean, Tagger 2 were kind of add-on programs for free to Final Draft, and that allowed you to kind of tag elements in a script and then export that into something that was more meaningful to a budgeting or scheduling program. And at this point, we've really replaced all that, you know, those add-on programs with tagging features directly in Final Draft 11. And that's where, I mean, you and I have been working together to kind of round out exactly what that should look and feel like to save as much time as possible for people in your position.
It's kind of interesting because the original Tagger and then Tagger 2, I mean, that's got to be 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Tagger 2 gave it a little bit of help, but not much. The interface was not much different. And I used those because that was a cool way for me to be able to do some breakdown work and identify elements, whether it be cast members or stunts or vehicles or props or special effects, any of the normal things that we do in breaking down and evaluating the requirements we're going to have to put in front of and behind camera. And then it had a way of exporting that information to what's known as an SEX file. They came up with that. Probably just stands for script export or something.
I think it's a scheduling export is the official.
Scheduling export, okay. And basically then Movie Magic Scheduling was able to import that file, and all those elements would go into the right places. However, it was very limited on some levels as far as things it could and could not inject. Which is part of what you and I worked on. Mm-hmm. And actually, even though it was cumbersome and antiquated, I even used it up till, you know, a couple of years ago, because I knew how to, with my workarounds, make it functional, but it was a bit painful and tedious knowing that it was still antiquated. It was a piece of software in the Stone Age. I'm very excited about how it's turned out now with the development work you've done and consulting with me, which has been symbiotic, you know?
Yes, it absolutely has been. I think this has been a unique relationship in the way we've developed features. This is a very large feature, to be honest, tagging in general, a tags mode. But being able to go back and forth with you in real time and be able to, you know, hand this to someone who is at the top of the profession and then get that feedback as we sort of learn, okay, well, this clicking here and then clicking here is a little inconvenient. And we don't know that until someone really spends hours in it. And being able to do that in real time has been fantastic, even before we've released.
Yeah, the reason I was happy to work with you guys is because I wanted to hopefully make this to a point where it could be less hours, or whatever hours I invested would be more productive.
Right. So let's get into how that process really looks. I mean, behind the tool of the tags mode in Final Draft 11, what's the process of tagging and breaking down the script? What do you do first?
First of all, start out reading the script and getting a feel for the whole script in general. The script, as it would come to me, it may be something that has scene numbers or does not have scene numbers. The very first thing I do when I get a script, I always ask for a final draft file on the projects I'm going to work on, because then I can do my own processing work. It's my breakdown work is never going to go back to the writer unless the writer really wanted it. I don't think it would help a writer at all. But I take the final draft file that I get. I'll preserve that original. I make a duplicate that then becomes my breakdown script. And then I will adjust immediately. I'll scene number the script if it's not scene numbered. I will proof where scene headings are and where they are not. There's a lot of times where a writer in their process, a formatting of a line or a scene heading doesn't get the scene heading format element on it. It might be done as action or something of that nature, and that then does not translate into the export as a scene. So I proof it all, and I make sure that every place that should have a scene heading is going to have one, and it's going to be structured. I've had lines where it just says the set name, and then it says dash continuous, or later in the day, or just later. Now those aren't designations that work for your time of day. The typical scene heading is going to have whether it's an interior, an exterior, an interior slash exterior, something of that nature. Then the set name, and then the time of day, whether it's night, day, afternoon, morning, dusk, sunset, whatever the more common ones are, morning, let's say.
Right.
And then those things, those are the basic elements that we need when we're going to assimilate a script into a schedule. Probably most of the assistant directors you will find, they will take a hard copy script and they will scratch in their notes and do that sort of stuff. And they will manually go page by page and enter all of their information into separate breakdown pages in Movie Magic scheduling. And there's a number of people that's how they like to work, and they will probably forever want to work that way. But there are some people who like to do what I do and come up with a way to work inside the script. That's really why I like using Final Draft and why I like Tagger, is because it puts me into the script and I can do some of my work and I can think inside the script and make notes essentially that go into categories, elements that I'm going to want in my breakdown in Movie Magic scheduling. And there it goes. So the process of tagging, if you will, which is highlighting almost anything within a scene and then denoting what it's going to be, whether it's a cast member, whether it's an extra or background, or things that you can visualize that are not even in the script page or the script scene. It's just stuff that you know is going to be there. Part of doing a proper breakdown of any UPM or assistant director is doing this process, is you will sometimes have a scene where maybe a particular actor is mentioned or not. And let's say the ones that are mentioned, they'll carry through into your automatic breakdown. But there's some people who you know, and they're not named in the scene, but you know they happen to be in that office, in that room, in the house, or they're close at hand, or they're going to be somehow with your actors that are mentioned. And you're going to make sure that you make a note and you include them in your breakdown, so that when you schedule it, you know what actors you need available for particular scenes on particular days, and that you don't overlook that need. That's part of it. But I, again, like I say, I customize the script, my breakdown script, not that it's going to go out to anybody else, but it's a work script for myself, the same way I've scratched notes on a hard copy script and translate them by manually into movie management scheduling. I will have most of my notes on the actual script in the final draft file. And that is my duplicate, my separate breakdown final draft file. Then from there, I can get all my elements straightened out. I can double check it, proof it on final draft before I then export it and import it into Movie Magic Scheduling. Once I'm there in Movie Magic Scheduling, I'll double check things to make sure they translated across. I've never had really a problem with that if I do the breakdown correctly in final draft. So it's a very interesting thing. It's a tremendously useful tool to me. I don't know how many people are aware of what Tagger does, because a lot of people didn't want to embrace that ancient piece of software that until now was the only thing available like that. And you had to open up a separate program in order to run. Now the Tagger is part of the main program, and you work with it together in the same space. That's cool.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a lot easier in the workflow. You touched on something that we just kind of glossed over, but I think it speaks to this concept that we've discussed a little bit on this podcast before, and plenty of other people have too. But there really are two types of scripts, and they almost have nothing to do with each other. One is the script that a writer writes and tries to get people excited about it, about that project, the selling script, essentially, the marketing script that markets the movie or the TV show we're trying to market. The other document is
Before you go to the other document, let me tell you, with that, I'm very sensitive to that with the scripts I get when I'm doing an early evaluation breakdown. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to change that as far as what other people are going to see, because the writer has made that in such a way that it is designed to keep the reader flowing and get involved in the story and not be encumbered by too rigid a scene structure with the scene headings in certain ways and scene numbers, and it becomes kind of a rigid as a situation instead of free flowing, and the way those scene headings are written. That's why I make a separate copy for myself for my breakdown, but I try not to do anything that's going to interfere with the way that selling script is, unless somebody wants it that way, wants it to be tweaked up a bit, give it some scene numbers, whatever. When I give the studio my breakdown, oftentimes I'll give them the breakdown script with the scene numbers and other things so they can have a reference as far as what matches up to what. It's very important, and writers are very sensitive, and rightly so, to want to preserve the way they formatted it for their readership. Could be the network, could be the studio feature department division, or anybody else.
Yeah.
And at an early phase, it's very important to preserve that. So that, again, I'm working off of something that's separate, but I have to translate it into a functional breakdown and schedule that can be budgeted.
Yeah, and that sounds like that second thing, that functional blueprint, essentially technical document as that second part. You mentioned interior and exterior as the first part of the scene heading, and every writer knows to do that in general, even when we have to break the rules. But why is that important? That's the first piece of a scene.
Common usage as far as the way we do schedules. And usually when we look at a one-line schedule or a detailed schedule, the common order of things that we see on a page will be scene number, whether it's exterior, interior, etc., the set name, and then the time of day, day, night, whatever, and then the length of the scene. How many pages? Eighths of a pages is our measurement always. So it could be 4/8 of a page or 2 5/8 of a page or something like that. And then, you know, we're going to get into a very truncated synopsis that just identifies the nature of the action or storytelling of the scene. And oftentimes that's in a matter of 10 words or less. It could be Jerry goes to the golf shop, and that's the whole thing. And it's merely a reference to help identify the scene, not to be something that you're going to share out. It's really for production purposes only, to give just a little tiny description what happens in the scene. And so those are the important first elements to it. And then, of course, you can go through the whole range of things that you would see on a breakdown page. And there's two things where we print out reports and stuff. It could be a one-line schedule, or it could be a full shooting schedule that lists every particular production element that is deemed to be important to take note of. Every department's going to make their own breakdowns for all of their things that are going to go much, much deeper. But there's always certain key elements that an assistant director particularly will want to take note of for distribution.
Yeah, okay.
But one thing I wanted to mention to you, and you were about to go to another thing. I'll save what I was going to mention. You were starting and I interrupted you.
I was going to get into another topic and just talk about how story goes back and forth with scheduling, because making a schedule, making a budget, learning something while you're doing that then often influences the story itself, and you've got to do some rewrites based on those things.
Yes, absolutely is the case. Let's take it down not into a feature structure, but let's say take it down into episodic. Mm-hmm. A lot of times in my role as a producer on a TV series or some other, I will get a copy of an outline, an advance of stories coming up down the road. The scripts aren't ready yet, but it's an outline of what scenes are going to happen, pretty much the order that's anticipated. And from those, we get an idea of what to expect and what kind of requirements are likely. Now, there's a variety of things. I will look at an outline and I will make a bunch of notes and then I'll start talking about stuff. But I don't know how long the individual scenes may or may not be. I have to kind of make some guesstimates on that, and I have to look for things that are within the, you might get things broken down kind of like scenes or story points. They're sort of like descriptions of what a scene might be. But within that, there can be other little things that you catch that you say, oh, that's going to be a scene within that scene. Maybe there's two or three scenes that in order to portray what's written in that slug paragraph. What I will do, and a lot of people don't know this, but I've come up with my own way of basically ingesting, scanning and ingesting an outline and creating that into final draft, and then breaking it up in my own way to do hypothetical scenes with the slugs and scene numbers a rough translation of what page count might happen from it, and then spitting that out into Movie Magic scheduling and doing a hypothetical evaluation of how I think it might boil down into, say, an 8-day shooting schedule for that episode. And then it gives me an idea. What you're doing is you're looking for the vulnerabilities and achievability, and are the requirements going to kind of fit into some sort of balance that you can accomplish in the 8 days allotted? And there's some things that look like they may be complicated, or maybe stretch guest actors too long or something, then you're going to go back, have some powwows with the showrunner and anybody else who has some creative input, and just start to talk about the pros and cons of what you have to do to deliver within the time and within the budget. And then look towards perhaps, okay, maybe this particular scene, it's written for right next to the park. Could that be in the office outdoor patio or something, rather, something that's a little more accessible, something that you might be able to do on a studio lot as opposed to a location, because it might give you too much logistical stuff and you can only afford taking your shooting company on location 3 days out of that 8 days. But the nature of the work, as you see it, it's going to, oh, this is going to be something we're going to need to be out on location 5 days. Well, that's a very large additional cost in the show, because you have to add drivers and other elements to go shoot on location versus on stage.
So at that point, you might really want to tell the writers, guys, rethink this scene or rethink this episode.
Yeah, and when I break down an outline in this way, I'm using that process to think about it, visualize it. While I'm going through this little process, it's percolating in my brain. And I'm looking to come up with a spitball estimate of the amount of time we need for those various things, stage versus location days, versus set construction, versus number of extras, number of this, that, and the other, just a feel for it so that I can do maybe a spitball estimate that's not something done with, you know, money on a page, piece of paper, but it's just something you know from experience that you're going to have some issues with, and maybe eat up some of the monies that you need for a whole slew of things. So you try to determine priorities, and you then look to see, is that particular episode one where we want to spend more than our pattern budget? Are we going to have a future episode to where we'll be able to spend less so that we can even it out over the course of the number of shows going to be shot for that season? These days, seasons are shorter. You have very often 10 episode or 15 episode or somewhere in between the number of episodes that constitute a season on some shows, as opposed to the classic old thing, a full season might be 22, 23 episodes, even 24. Those happen still, but they happen less frequently.
Yeah, it seems like the percentage of new shows as the industry increased, all the TV and streaming we have not increased the number of 24 episode pickups. All right, well, I know we have to wrap up here, so I'd like to ask you about some of the work you do with the Directors Guild, the DGA, and how involved you are in kind of the echelons of the DGA.
Well, you mentioned the Frank Capra Award that the Directors Guild gave me, and you mentioned that was for career achievement. Actually, it's for career achievement and service to the Directors Guild. Mm. So it's kind of 50-50 on those counts. I found, you know, all of us look for ways sometimes to give back to people in our industry, people in, you know, the other lives, other aspects of our lives. It's just one that seemed to be a good fit, and I was able to contribute to some of the things that relate to my peers as well as myself. And so over the years, I've been on a ton of committees. I've been on the last 8 Directors Guild negotiations committees, on the negotiations themselves. I was ADUPM council chair for 5 years, and I've been on the national board for a number of years now, and currently serve on the national board and on the ADUPM council, currently council chair. It's just something to where once you're in and doing it, you feel like, sure, I can contribute something. And as your time permits, you do so. If you're on a location, you have to deal with it differently. I produced a film in Japan. I was there for about 5 months at the time I was council chair. I stayed in touch with them, and we have a vice chair, and we'll take over running the meetings and stuff. And I'd stay in tune from afar, emails, phone calls, and the like. I could still do a lot of that work. It's the old adage that a busy person can always handle something else.
Yes, it's quite true. Cleve, can you tell us where people can find you, people can find information on you, or what you're working on next, what we can look forward to?
Well, at the moment, I'm enjoying some time off and with family, and it's been really great. But I can be reached probably through the website, zcleve.com, or I can be emailed at zcleve@mac.com. I have an adjunct thing that's been going on as a sidebar without advertising called Cleve Movie Tools. It's just something that's calendars and quick references that I use, and I started sharing at the behest of a studio executive 20, 25 years ago.
Wow.
And people won't let me stop. So, so I had to put together a little website. So, I mean, that's where you'll find a little bit of information about me. Somewhat cryptic. ZCleve.com is what it is. Z as in zebra, C-L-E-V-E.
All right. Well, Cleve, last question before we go. I think the landscape is probably different now for someone getting into producing on the level you're at than it was when you started. But what advice, seeing what you see from the top-down kind of experience view to the newbies, what do you see as a good piece of advice for the people who are starting out on this line?
That's a tough question, because I actually think that there are more avenues for people to carve a path in our industry today because of how many different distribution modes we have, whether it be YouTube or it be all the different streaming circumstances that are out there, people doing their own videos, posting stuff on Vimeo or whatever it is, or just getting a chance to work on low-budget fare that's going to be what we call part of new media. And there are those opportunities. So there is no one way. And my recommendation to anybody who's carving a path is never stop doing homework, never stop learning about anything you can associated with not just what you do, but what other people do, because it'll help you work better with the other people. At the end of the day, if you work better with all the other people of different disciplines, then people will want to work with you that much more. And I think that I've always been a student of the craft, and I've been a seminar junkie for many decades, because if I could learn one more little tidbit of information, it would just make me more complete, help me remain on the cutting edge. And I guess part of helping you with this new edition of Final Draft has helped me again stay on that cutting edge again.
Yeah, I think so. I would certainly think you'll be on the cutting edge for a couple of years after this.
I'm not stopping anytime soon.
Well, Cleve Landsberg, it has been a pleasure talking to you on the podcast. Cleve, thanks so much, man.
Well, you're most welcome. Happy to contribute.
And thank you out there for listening and leaving ratings and reviews for the podcast. Really flattered by that, honestly. Please keep doing that. If you haven't yet, give it a shot. And until then, we're happy to keep bringing you all the script writing and screenwriting and business advice we can possibly bring you. Until next time, I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Right on.